Good afternoon, everybody. I hope you're not too tired, as I am. it's difficult in the afternoon.
It's easier for the speaker.
It's easier for the speaker, so okay, you're right. So I try to give this tutorial on geometric complexity theory on matrix multiplication. So my goal is to give an overview so you can see what are the problems, what are the methods, what can we achieve, where are the difficulties. But I won't give proofs, maybe some indication of proof, and then I leave the details to Christian Ickemeyer, who is sitting here, and then I think Wednesday afternoon he will give more details. Okay, so I have a lot of time, so please feel free to interrupt me. If there is a question, there are boards on the side. If I'm going too fast, just ask me. I think there will be enough time. Let me start with the background and motivation. So the main motivation is the problem of tensor rank. We have heard about it quite a lot in this boot camp, but now we are in the workshop, and I cannot assume that everybody was at the boot camp. So the tensor rank is a natural mathematical concept. It arises in various places. And the connection to computer science is the relation to the computational complexity of evaluating bilinear maps. Yeah? And the famous problem is the problem to multiply matrices. Yeah? Okay, so there is this famous problem of the asymptotic complexity matrix multiplication, and we also hope to get some insights into this problem along this way. Right, there was, geometric complexity theory was proposed for the permanent versus determinant problem by Ketan Mulmule and Milly Zohony in 2001. And it has proved to be very difficult to implement. And so, so what I tried with Christian, former PhD student, he's sitting here. We tried to, make it more concrete, but it was difficult. But I realized from my time as a PhD student, being a PhD student of Volker Strassen, I knew all the setting of the tensors, and I realized that these things that Ketan Milin had done for forms can also be done for trilinear forms. It's quite analogous, and I tried to apply it in this setting. And then, yes, we developed this, and finally, it was also quite difficult, and finally we even managed to prove some lower bounds on the border rank of matrix multiplication by exhibiting representation theoretic obstructions. So these bounds don't beat the world record, but this is the first time that something has been proven along this way. I'm going to tell you about it. Okay, that's why. The world record, yeah, sorry? Yes?
Do you know the proof that previous lower bounds were not occurrence obstructions? Or
I'm going to discuss all this in my talk, so if you, that's just the overview. Okay, right. So our bounds have the same order of magnitude as the one by Strassen and Lichtig, but not as good as the bounds by Landsberg and Ottaviani. So this is, right. Good. So let me start with the definition. So the setting, all throughout the talk, I have three finite dimensional complex vector spaces, W1, W2, W3. And then I form the tensor product, which I call W. And the elements of the capital W are called tensors. Of course, I could take more factors than three, but the interesting things start when I have three factors. So I always have three factors, but things generalize, obviously. Okay, what is the rank? Well, a tensor W has rank 1 if it can be written as a tensor product of three vectors and if it is non-zero. And then what is the rank in general? It's the minimum number of summits that in such a decomposition. So I want to decompose, I want to write W as a sum of R tensors of rank 1. What is the minimum possible R? This is called the rank. Simple mathematical definition, but it's a complicated concept. Because if one of these vector spaces, let's say W3, is just one-dimensional, then we can drop this factor. And what we then have, just two factors, and essentially we're talking about linear maps. So an element in this product of these two would be just a linear map from the dual of W1 to W2. And this rank notion becomes the usual rank of matrices, and there we know everything. But as soon as we have a third factor, it becomes much more difficult. And there is an old theorem due to Johann Hastad that quantifies it, and he proved that the tensor rank is an NP-hard problem.
So this is Boolean or over complex numbers, this NP-hard?
It was both. So he had a statement over finite fields and over the rationals. Over the rationals, he proved it's NP-hard. But actually, it's not known whether it's in NP. So over finite fields, it's NP. Okay, let me go on with this connection to complexity. So if I have such a tensor W, so I can see it as a bilinear map. So if you know a little bit of multilinear algebra, then you know this is the same as a bilinear map from this product of the dual spaces, W3. Then we have the notion of non-scalar complexity. I don't want to define it formally, but it's the minimum number of non-scalar multiplications that are sufficient to evaluate this map by an arithmetic circuit or straight line program. So this is the notion L of phi, and then there was this result by Strassen. He noted that this complexity and the rank, they differ at most by a factor of 2. So I have this inequality, and so what I can do if I want to study complexity, I can replace it by the rank, and if I don't care about this factor of 2, I'm fine. And the rank is a very clean mathematical notion. Okay, that's why we study tensor rank in theoretical computer science. Okay, before I enter geometric complexity, yeah?
I do want to follow up with this question. So the rank is dependent also on the scalar field.
Sorry, the rank is dependent on?
Doesn't the rank in some sense depend on the field?
Interesting.
Yeah. What do you mean now? Right, so,
no,
yes.
The other tensor with the rational numbers was happen to use rings, irrational.
Yeah, I mean, if you'd make a field extension, then it can change the rank. Sure, it can change.
Yeah, yeah,
it can change.
So
there are easy examples that.
Right. Yeah, sure.
So, the field is fixed. But, sorry, okay.
Field,
okay. For me, the field is always complex numbers.
Okay, okay.
For me, that's difficult enough. Always complex numbers.
Okay?
Right, you're right. So, okay, let me briefly give the story of the records because there has been some progress recently. So there's something going on in algebraic complexity theory now. So here, for completeness, I have the matrix multiplication map that everybody knows. It has a tensor that I denote here by Mn. Okay, so and there has been an exciting result by Joseph Landsberg recently. And he proved that the rank of this matrix multiplication tensor is bounded from below by 3n squared plus lower order term. Yeah. And for a long time, Markus Bläser, who is also here, had the record of 2.5 n squared. You can see, so it took a long time to go from 2.5 to 3. So that's the kind of things.
Minus in the lower order.
Yeah, if I write O, I mean plus or minus sign. Minus. It's, for me, it's with absolute values. Okay, so you see, if one could replace these three by a log n, it would be just amazing. It would be a nonlinear lower bound. So maybe that's what we want. Okay, and then there is the story of the exponent. I think most of you that are in this audience know that. So the shortest way to define the exponent of matrix multiplication is probably this. You take the rank of Mn, take the logarithm with base n, and the limit. And this limit exists. That's easy to see. And then also here, there has been improvement. The old result of Coppersmith of Winograd from the 90s, he proved omega is bounded from above by 2.376. And there have been recent improvements by Davy and Stotters, Virginia Williams, and Legall this year. So you see, these digits have changed now. It's I mean, it took a long time from here to here to get some improvement.
Okay. I even got the best paper award for the experiment, I think.
Yes, I mean, if you do, if you improve after, it's a difficult problem. So we don't know what it is. And people believe it will be two, but
so
right.
So can I just, I mean, from the next question, if you actually define the matrix multiplication rank over some extension of the complexes, could it actually be smaller than?
No, I mean, what you can do, because they are already algebraically closed. If you have another field, like you gave from R to C, such things can happen, because like something factors into
the rank can change, the border rank won't change.
If the complex numbers are algebraically closed and uncountable, so they're sort of universal for anything.
I can give you an easy example, but maybe let's take it offline. When you go from R to C, the rank drops.
But if you do C adjoin a variable, then border rank becomes rank.
He's not talking about adjoining a variable.
That's what he's asking.
Oh, you want to adjoin a variable.
Yeah. Or a nil closed variable, you know, then the order rank becomes this.
Okay. Okay. Yes. Never. Yes. If you attach adjoin this epsilon, which is nilpotent, then I agree. Yeah, that's a point.
That's not a field.
But it's not a field anymore.
Well, I'm not saying it's a field, but I didn't understand. That's what I understood the question.
But if the field is algebraically closed, it's already closed. Yeah. And then.
But there might be a difference between Q bar and C, but not once you go to C. Because C is uncountable.
It can be proved. It's a result by Schoenhage that over Q bar and C, it's the same. And it only depends on the characteristic of the field. Uh-huh. The exponent. It's only for the exponent. So there might be different omegas for different characteristics, but we don't know that. Okay, but let me go on. I would like to focus on other things. There's this notion of border rank, which is, I remember George Ottaviani is here. He once told me that border rank, rank shouldn't be here. It should only be border rank. You're right. So it's much more natural from a geometer's point of view. But I have to go the other way. So let me define the border rank in the simplest possible way. So what is the border rank of a tensor W? It's the minimum natural number R such that there exists a sequence WK of tensors which converges to W and such that all of these WK have rank at most R. So this is like a calculus definition of border rank. Maybe not the nicest, but yeah. Okay, and here convergence maybe with respect to Euclidean metric. So the reason to have this definition is that there are examples when you go to a limit that the rank can jump up. So it's not semi-continuous and we don't want to have this. And by using this definition, we eliminate this problem. It becomes semi-continuous. So this is trivial. Border rank is less than or equal rank. And there is a non-trivial fact, Virginia in the boot camp, she proved it, that if you replace rank by border rank, you still get the same exponent. So if you are only interested in these asymptotic investigations, it's the same. You can use border rank. Okay. So also here we have seen progress. So that's very exciting that after all these years, there has been progress. There's a very exciting result by Joseph Landsberg and George Ottaviani, and they proved this lower bound for the border rank of the matrix multiplication tensor is bounded by 2n squared minus n. And before, the record was held by Thomas Lichtig, who had 1.5n squared plus something. So again, 1.5 to 2. And this is the actually important thing also for the rank lower bound by Joseph. Okay. Good. So that's the state of the art. Now, let me make the connection to the geometry. Border rank can be seen as an orbit closure problem. So we need to have a group. The group in our setting will be GL, the general linear group of W1 times GLW2 times GLW3. It acts on the tensor space just via tensor product. So in the most natural way. That's the action. So then we have an orbit. So what is the orbit? We have this W and we apply to it all group elements. That's called the orbit. The orbit has a closure. Okay. Now it's very important to understand there are different closures, but they give the same result. So the way I defined border rank was using, say, Euclidean topology, but geometers think in terms of Zariski topology, and it's the same. But that's a non-trivial result. So, but we take it for granted. And that's important, so we can now think of it as a Zariski closure, and this is very helpful. Okay. So also, I mean, in fact, we are talking about projective varieties, but because these things are cones. And if an element is here, I can multiply it with a scalar, it will be still in here. So these are essentially cones of a projective varieties. But I think the notation is simpler if I use always this affine writing. So now, okay, in order to make the connection to the, what? Yeah. I have to define what is the easy problem. Yeah, in the permanent determinant problem, the easy problem is the determinant. What is the easy problem here? It comes from the unit tensor. So let's assume that R is less than or equal to the dimensions of all these vector spaces that I have here. Then I can define an R's unit tensor in the following way. In all of these spaces, W2, W1, W2, W3, I choose a basis, whatever. Okay, and then I form this. So this is just a tensor, the first elements in these spaces, the second, the third, and I add them up. Then I get this. Of course, this is dependent on the choice of the basis, but the orbit of this thing is base independent. This I call R's unit tensor. Okay?
R must be less than n, right?
Sorry?
Yeah,
always. It's an important comment. I mean, maybe you have a tensor, it's in a space of dimension 3 times 3 times 3, and you want to know whether the rank is at less than 6 or so. Then you have to enlarge the space. But this you can always do. Okay? So artificially, it's a kind of padding, but it's not as, it's quite an easy padding. Yeah. Okay, so there is the okay, let me mention this important observation by Volker Strassen. Okay, he observed that the border rank of W is less than or equal to R if and only if W is in the orbit closure of the R-th unit tensor. And this, of course, is equivalent to the statement that this orbit closure of W is contained in this. This is not difficult to prove. This is quite easy to prove. So it's not a deep result. But it's important because it connects this problem to orbit closures. And as we learned before in the tutorial by Laurent Manivelle, orbit closures is what is investigated in geometric invariant theory. Okay. So, questions? Or?
So you said that this is the easy problem. So what was the easy problem
here? The easy problem, the easy bilinear problem, this tensor is the easy problem. Or if you want, well, it corresponds to a bilinear map, and this is just component-wise multiplication. Like x1 up to xr, y1 up to ir, component-wise multiplication. So, okay. So now let me discuss the basic ideas for lower bounds. So it will be quite general what I'm discussing. First, orbit closure problems. I have a reductive algebraic group G that acts linear on a vector space W. So think of GLM or a product of such groups. Then I have a different notation than Laurent used for the ring of polynomial functions on W. I write O of W, but that's the same as the C. Okay, it's the same as in Laurent. I use this notation, and I use this notation, but it's just the same object. Okay. Because I deal with cones, I have a grading with respect to degree. So I can talk about the degree D component. I have this direct decomposition. And there is the notion of the vanishing ideal of the orbit closure is defined as follows. It consists of all polynomial functions on W that vanish on this orbit closure. That's the vanishing ideal, and that's, we would like to understand it. That's very difficult. But you observe the following elementary fact. Well, okay, if let's assume I have another tensor V that is not in the closure of W, then I can separate V from this orbit closure by a function in the vanishing ideal. There is a function f in the vanishing ideal that does not vanish at V. And this is just a consequence of the fact that I'm talking here about the Zariski closure. The Zariski closure, by definition, is the zero set of polynomials. So this is actually trivial. Okay, if you put here Zariski closure, it's trivial. Okay. So, and this is already very simple, but it's some idea. I mean, this is a way, or this is already, if you want, some flip. If you want to prove this, this means proving a lower bound. So we only have to exhibit such an F. Okay. This is as a witness. Okay, that's an idea. Okay, but of course that's not so simple. I mean, we don't know in which degrees to search. Yeah, in which degrees should we look for such a thing? And even if the degree is small, this still has a huge dimension. So it's not an easy problem. Okay, but here comes in representation theory. Representation theory allows kind of a guided search for F. It allows for a dimension reduction. So it becomes more doable than without representation theory. Okay? Good. So let me discuss representations in the rings of regular functions. So I have this ring of polynomial functions on my tensor space. The group G acts on this ring just in the following way. Here is the definition. What does it mean to apply the group element G to F? Well, if evaluating at W just means this. It's like if you want, I have coordinate transformations and they give me a transformation of the functions on the space. This is natural definition. And then I notice immediately that the vanishing ideal of such an orbit closure is gene variant just because this orbit closure is gene variant. Okay. So now comes in representation theory. So what this is all about? Well, the point is this, well, I have this linear action of the group on this vector space, so this is a G module. Okay, and this also decomposes in the degree D parts. Then the degree D part is finite dimensional, and this I can split into a direct sum of irreducible models. So I want to have, like, the action of these group elements, I want a simultaneous block decomposition, essentially. Yeah? And this is possible because G is reductive. Okay, that's always a difficult point when I talk about these things, because a lot of concepts come in, and then if you've never seen that before, it's difficult. But even if you haven't seen it before, I think we should be able to follow the main lines of my discussion. Well, there's the notion of irreducible module, and these irreducible modules, these isomorphic types can be classified. That's a classical theory due to Schur and Young, and it's classified by discrete data. And in this setting, such a discrete data, lambda, will be just a triple of partitions. So I don't have time to give the invariant definition, so believe me, such a lambda bar, okay? Maybe I should give an example, but you tell me. And this lambda, this will be a partition, okay? Some D. So what is the partition? For instance, 5, 3, 1. It's a decrease in sequence of integers. It's a partition of 9. Okay, and it has a most 3 parts, so sometimes I put the 3 here. It's a partition. So I take 3 of these things, and they describe an irreducible module. Get it all this way. And the reason that I have 3 partitions is because my group is a product of 3 GLs. So I'd be happy to give more information about that if you wish. Okay, so these lambdas are called highest weights. Now, maybe we not only want to talk about the types, maybe we want to talk about the modules themselves. They sit somewhere here. Okay. So now, again, general theory tells us that such irreducible modules, they have a unique... Okay, there is a very nice vector in it which generates them, which is called the highest weight vector, or in this case, let's say highest weight function. So this function generates it, and this is characterized. Let me give an example. If the group is just a GLM, not a product of three of them, just one of them, so what we do. In this group, we have this subgroup of unipotent matrices. Okay. On what I want to have, what I require from this, when I have F, highest weight vector. Now, this is completely general. I have two conditions. One is it should be an invariant with respect to this group U. So it's a U invariant. Okay, and I have another group. This is just the group of the diagonal matrices. Okay. Invertible, of course. And the second condition is that if I apply such a T, I get a multiple of F. So this will be some of this form. So N by N. You see, this is like, if you want, F is an eigenvector with respect to this operation. Okay. And here these lambdas that appear here, okay, the couple of these exponents is the weight. So, okay. Example, maybe. Can you see it here? Here is an example. I have n variables, homogeneous polynomials of degree d, GLn action, and the question is, well, it's known that this is irreducible. So meaning that the only proper invariant GLn invariant subspace of this is trivial, is zero. There's nothing else. That's a theorem. So now, I claim that there should be a unique highest weight vector in this. So what is it? So I have to find a polynomial here that is invariant under the action of this unipotent upper thing. And then if you think about it for a moment, then you realize one should take this. It's the highest weight vector. And it's an exercise, simple exercise, to convince oneself this is the only up to scaling.
I think it should be xn to the...
I did it wrong.
Because of the inverse?
The question is, how is the question is, how is the action?
It's U inverse n.
The question is, how is the action? So maybe you're right. These things I always get wrong. The question is, what do I write here? Maybe let me put an X here. I think Jan is right. Yeah. Now, I don't want to put G to the minus 1, so I think I have to put the transpose. Well, what do you mean?
Your definition is G inverse.
You need G inverse
because it's the dual.
I need to be the inverse, then.
Well, no, transpose still makes the left action. Yeah. Then he has to use lower triangular.
Right.
If you want transpose, you have to use lower triangular.
I don't want to use transpose. So,
inverse, you're fine.
Is it not 1? Is it n? Is he right? Not 1? It's 1. I think it's 1.
It's 1 if you use inverse.
Yeah, I wanted to use inverse. But don't worry. I mean, it's the same problem. Do we have to put the dual or not?
No.
Okay. Okay, it's good, but we had some time to think about it. But what I wanted to say here, this space, now, this space has a very big dimension. Already very, very big. Now assume such in this here, you have this piece appearing, and this has a big dimension. But what I want to do, I want to say, I don't care, I can focus on the highest weight vector, and it will be just one. So I already have a reduction in dimension, which is exponential, yeah, in the search for these functions. Okay, so again, I had this observation, which was easy. And now I can refine it, but this takes some thought, but it's not difficult. Now, again, when V is not in the orbit closure of W. This means exactly there is an F in the vanishing ideal of the orbit closure that does not vanish on the orbit of V. Now I have modified it. Before it was V, now I put the orbit, so I have to. It's equivalent. But now the observation is one may take for F a highest weight function. Easy to see, but I don't give the proof. Okay, it means, now we can focus on highest weight functions. It's an if and only if. Okay? Right. So right now, one should give examples. Now there will be an example. Old example, going back to Strassen's work from 83. Strassen's resultant for three slice tensors. So now assume I have a space of dimension format MM3. So I can, of course I have the standard basis, and I think of an element here as a triple of matrices. So it's just like I have three slices, triple of matrices, A, B, C. And then Strassen came up with this function that nowadays we understand much better. So I just wrote the definition. And this function is a semi-invariant, so meaning that it doesn't look like a polynomial, but if you look, because there is an inverse here, but if you look closer, then there is some, cancellation, so it's in fact a polynomial, and it is a semi-invariant. One can prove that the following holds. So if you, this Fm, you W, and you transform it with this group element, what you get is a multiple, here should be an M, I'm sorry, you get a multiple of F, and the scalar factor, which is the product of the powers of these determinants. So, if I had a little bit more time, one could derive how this works. So Giorgio Ottaviani and Joseph Landsberg have a very nice way of explaining all these things. So we understand it much better nowadays. But the important thing is not that it's an invariant. The important thing is that this guy vanishes on the tensors of border rank less than 3m½. Okay. So that's what Strassen found. And now see, this is an example of a highest weight function. So this is even a semi-invariant. The semi-invariant are highest weight functions where the weight is rectangular. So you see, it's 5, 3, 1. Usually, the representations here, you like to represent this partition by a so-called Young diagram. So you put 5, you have 5 boxes in the first line, 3 boxes in the second, 1 box in the last. This is a Young diagram. Okay, and sometimes it's nice to have a rectangular Young diagram.
Something like that,
and these correspond to semi-invariants, and this is an example of such a thing. So, the lower bound by Marcus Bleser for rank on matrix multiplication crucially relied on this resultant. So it's somehow, you see, this is important. Okay. So let me go on with this. Now, this was an example. Let me go on with the general discussion. Okay. So, So I define, I can also look at the ring of regular functions on the orbit closure just by restricting polynomial functions on the overall space to this orbit closure. Then I denote this ring this way. Okay. So then I have just a restriction. Gives me a surjective ring morphism, which is
G invariant.
So this is now these are just general observations and nothing's happening here. Again, I have these are cones, so I have the grading of the ring, And these degree d parts are finitely generated g modules. So again, g is reductive, so I can split those. I have this notation, v lambda g just stands for some irreducible g modules of highest weight lambda. Okay, it's abstract. It's not realized concrete, it's just abstract. And then I can think of this splitting. I have this g module or g representation, and there is a splitting in the irreducible ones, and they come with a certain multiplicity, which I denote this way. And we are interested in these multiplicities. Yeah. Why? Okay, because, well, there is this idea, I think, which appeared in GCT1 paper, I think very beautiful idea, the idea of comparing multiplicities. Okay. Assume the orbit closure of V is contained in the orbit closure of W. So we actually want to show that this is not the case. So assume by contradiction we have this. Then, very easy to see, for all highest weights, lambda, we have this inequality of multiplicities. And here is the proof, very simple. We just have we have the restriction of regular functions. This yields for all degree a surjective G module morphism, and then I use Schur's lemma. Well, this is almost immediate. So Schur's lemma says that an irreducible, when I map it with a G module morphism, it will be isomorphic or will go to zero. Even it survives or it gets completely killed. Okay. So now a representation theoretic obstruction consists of such a lambda bar which violates this inequality.
Good.
So, right. So now, okay, what do we do? There was an interesting paper by Matthias Christandl and co-authors.
Yes? The F that separates the particle that's not in the closure, that's without oxygen now. That's
right. Yeah. Okay. That's exactly the issue you were in the open lecture. So that's what. Good. I will come to that, yes. Now I want to discuss whether multiplicities will be useful or not. There was a paper by Matthias Christandl, and okay, what he said basically that multiplicities cannot be of help for asymptotic considerations. The observation was this, that okay, if you want to okay, we have such a situation, then I mean the dimensions we can always compute in the situations of interest. So let's assume the dimension of GV bar is less than the dimension of GW bar, so we know that already. And let's assume that we have this containment. Then one can deduce from mathematical considerations that the multiplicity here on the right-hand side grows.
What's KW?
K, good question.
Is that W tensor to the K?
Oh, I shouldn't write. I cannot write here. Sorry. Okay. What I mean is this.
There's no screen, so you can make corrections. Sorry.
I mean, right. So what I do the stretching with the highest weights. Okay? That's what I mean.
So it should be K applied to lambda, not applied to W. W is fixed.
W is fixed, and then I have this weight lambda bar, and then I want to see what happens if I replace lambda by k times lambda. How fast do these multiplicities grow?
So you're scratching lambda.
Right. And the point is that this grows the rate with this grows is essentially the dimension of this. Not quite, but essentially. So, I mean, if you have this inequality, then the point is then this grow on at a much higher rate than these. Meaning that it could be possible to work with multiplicities, but not asymptotically.
Is this specific to the tensor scenario?
It's general, completely general.
So I think you understand the statement.
Okay.
Part of it is, I can't see it.
Sorry.
So
Matthias is here.
Yeah,
please answer his questions. Give me a break.
So if we rescale the partition, then the rescaling in the big one grows faster than the rescaling in the small one. So why is this a problem?
It's not a problem.
But Peter presented it as a problem.
But there's a bit of history to that. So Peter had this idea that you should look at the support of the polytopes to distinguish occurrence and non-occurrence.
Which polytopes?
Oh, so for...
Already in the discussion session, so this will add... No, I will get enough time to finish, but... The question is whether we should do this now
no,
or...
I want to understand...
Okay,
this.
Good.
So
okay,
this is
go on.
This is a legitimate question.
Okay, let's go on. Good.
So, Peter had this idea that you could look at, say, the polytope for the determinant and the permanent and try to distinguish them. Right? The asymptotic, basically the asymptotic question of whether the multiplicities are zero or non-zero. But now there's a very natural extension of that idea, and that would be to look at the so-called Dustermann-Heckmann measure,
mm-hmm.
which is this multiplicity divided by its highest growth. And basically, what that says is, that statement says that that they are incomparable. One multiplicity just grows faster than the other, so there's nothing to compare in this Dustermann-Heckmann measure.
So it's, this is not bad news for any idea you presented, this is bad news for an idea that you did not present then.
I want to okay. I wanted to motivate the next. Okay, I wanted to motivate what we are going to do. Please.
No, but the point is.
I wanted to motivate occurrence obstructions. Okay, I wanted to say, maybe we should forget about the actual values of these multiplicities and only care whether they are zero or not. But it's just a motivation. Okay, just a motivation. So I defined an occurrence obstruction. It's a lambda such that the multiplicity of the W, so of the easy problem, is zero, and the other problem that's presumably hard has a positive multiplicity. Okay.
This witnesses that one over closure is not containing the other. Is that
yes, yes, yes. Okay. It is to that. Yeah. So now, to your comment, so what does this mean? Okay, what does this mean? So this... If the multiplicity of this W is zero, means the type lambda does not occur in the orbit closure of the W, and this means that all highest weight functions of weight lambda, they vanish here. Okay? So there are such functions on the overall big space, but they all vanish on this. This is a strong condition, especially if the multiplicity of the big thing is big, then it's a very strong condition. But I think it's a very elegant idea to try this. Yeah, it gives lots of simplifications, but it's not clear that it can work. Whereas the idea of highest weight vectors, it has to work. Okay. So and then okay. So maybe you see Strassen's example is not an occurrence obstruction. So if you can take this example 4, 4, 3, and then you find there is another semi-n variant of the same weight, but which doesn't weight on tensors of rank of most 5. So there is one that is good and the other is not good.
Do you know about whether Lichtig's equations are occurrence obstruction?
I think there were no explicit equations.
Right, but they are polynomial conditions. And I know...
Also, in your proof, on your result with Giorgio, I don't see clearly the... I mean, flat rank conditions.
We describe the modules. We
may
not.
Do.
Okay. The thing is, there's many irreducibles.
Yeah,
so
probably
the equations, and then there's also Grieser's equations, which almost give Lichtig's bound also. But those I tried for that, but I didn't try for Lichtig.
Okay. We will see one example of occurrence obstruction.
Yeah.
Okay. But okay. This is my warning. So sorry, I'm going to.
Wait, just to summarize, we don't know about other equations that are not occurrence obstruction. We just know about one example, which is yes, occurrence obstruction. Is it correct?
There will be one sequence of occurrence obstructions that I will show you. Okay. So the warning is, okay, while it is true that in principle orbit closure problems can always be disproved using highest weight function, it's not clear that one can always do so with occurrence obstructions. But one has to be optimistic. One has to check it. Yeah. That's what I try to do.
Other than we know the conclusion of your talk, you could replace always by ever. Previous to your paper, I think the question was ever.
Ever. Yeah, okay.
Can you repeat that?
I didn't understand it in detail, but I don't care at the moment because I have to focus on what. Okay. Let's go on, please. It's very interactive, so I like that, but I have to. There are some things that I want to tell you. Okay. So, what tools do we have for determining these multiplicities? So, the first thing we do, we decompose the functions on the tensor space. So this is here I have the degree d component. It decomposes into irreducibles, and the multiplicities that arise here are called Kronecker coefficients. So this you can take as a definition of Kronecker coefficients if you want. And there is sure the Weyl duality, a general principle in representation theory, which allows to identify these Kronecker coefficients also in terms of representations of symmetric groups. So here is the other way of characterizing them. So now, again, I have partition lambda I, and this labels an irreducible module over the symmetric group SD. Now, if you take the tensor product of three of these guys, and you wonder what is the dimension of the space of SD invariants, that's exactly this Kronecker coefficient. Combinatorial notion somehow. But the problem is, a big problem is, I mean, these Kronecker coefficients, they pop up everywhere. And we don't even have a combinatorial characterizations of these quantities. They are natural numbers. We would believe they count something, so there should be a function in sharp P, we believe, but it's not proven. We don't know. That's a big problem in algebraic combinatorics. Okay. Here's an example, but maybe let me jump over it.
Okay, because I'm running short of time. Okay.
Right, now I look now at the set of those highest weight lambdas which occur in the decomposition of the overall space. So this is this. Those lambdas where the Kronecker is positive, now you see they have to be a partition of the same integer d, and then okay, at most mi parts, if the dimension is here mi. This is a monoid. So if I add two lambdas, lambda mu, I'm still in this.
Can I ask you something quickly about that? So you said you don't know combinatorial description, but if you're starting at three, do they have a meaning with two or one?
Excuse me? If
Are there coefficients for one or two? I mean, can those be...
What do you mean for one or two?
So the
triple.
Right, of course.
Yeah, if I have two, it's trivial. Then it's just this. If lambda equals mu is one, otherwise it's zero. And if you have more, it's complicated. Okay. So this is a monoid. This is an important. So yeah, I can add those. And then.
What does the middle acquisition mean? Lambda v dash my mean?
Okay, so this so this means, maybe I put the index up here. This means I have at most m parts but that are non-zero, and the sum of the parts, most m parts. Okay, now you see, if I want to have a global understanding of these occurring obstructions, it's natural to look at the set of those lambda which occur in the coordinate ring of orbit closure, so where the multiplicity is positive. That's a monoid, okay? I call it a monoid of representations of W. Okay, general principles imply that those are finitely generated. Actually, Laurent gave a proof of this in some special case in the tutorial before. They are finitely generated.
So both of those, not just
both. It's very general. So and then we have this restriction homomorphism. This immediately implies, again, we are Schur's lemma, that this monoid of representations of W is contained in this Kronecker monoid. So the Kronecker monoid, the big thing, contains all of these. And we can also, it's not hard to prove that if we take a generic tensor, we have equality. Doesn't mean that, you see, this is a complicated object. This is complicated. So now the real cone generated by this monoid is polyhedral because it's finitely generated. It's complicated, but to a certain extent it's understood, and Nicolas Resser, who is here, he's an expert on this, and he will talk about this. But you see, even for a generic tensor, this monoid is very complicated. Even the cone generated by it is difficult. So now occurrence obstructions for now, they are here. So W will be the easy thing, so this will be a unit tensor, and I have to look for lambdas that are in the Kronecker monoid, but not in this monoid. These are the objects of desire, if you want. Okay. So how can I go on with this? So one big idea is to replace orbit closures by orbits. Orbits are considerably easier to understand. Okay, I lose a lot of information, and I have to discuss this. So, I have to say what is the coordinate ring of an orbit, because the orbit is not closed. So this is defined as the ring of functions that can be locally written as the quotient of two polynomial functions. So this way it becomes an algebraic variety. Okay, I have to be quick here. And the coordinate ring of the orbit closure is a subring of the coordinate ring of the orbit. And then I have this inclusion, this equivariant, so I get an inequality of multiplicities. On the left-hand side, these are the numbers that I'm actually interested in. And I can upper bound then by the corresponding multiplicities for orbit. Okay. The point is that for this upper bound, we have formulas. I mean, they are complicated, but we have formulas for this. Yeah? But we don't have formula for this. Yeah. So we have no systematic way to compute these multiplicities. And okay, so in the example that I'm going to show, what happens that in this family that I will show you, this will be zero. So as a consequence, this will be zero. Okay, now things that have popped up several times already. There's this Peter Weyl theorem. So what we do, we look at the stabilizer of the tensor. It's defined here. It describes the symmetries. It's the isotropic group. And, now if I take an irreducible G-module here, the group acts here, and I can look at the space of invariance with respect to the action of the stabilizer. It's written here what it is. And there is this theorem, which is straightforward consequence of the algebraic Peter Weyl theorem. Many of you in the audience know that, and the others just believe it, that this multiplicity for the orbit, not for the orbit closure, for the orbit, is just the dimension of this space of stabilizers, of space of invariance of the stabilizer group.
In the dual representation.
Dual? I have to put the dual?
Yeah, you forgot a dual. It's okay.
Are you sure?
I'm sure.
We can discuss this, okay? It's again the problem with the star. Okay, but this is an important link because now, you see, this is group theoretic here. We just only have to know the stabilizer and then we can express this. So, an example. There is this result that describes the stabilizer of a generic tensor. I put the question mark here because I don't know for reference, so I'm not even 100% sure that it's okay, but I think so. So let's assume M is greater than or equal 3. The stabilizer of almost all W of the format MMM is trivial in the sense that we only have these the multiples of the identity with this trivial property. So now if you use this, plug this in the theorem from before, then we understand what is the monoid of lambda for the orbit. Of the orbit of generic tensors, it's just this. And this, okay, it's this, and this, the only condition that enters is the condition that here I have triples of partitions of the same size, nothing else. So this is huge. It's huge. It's the only condition. So essentially no condition. By contrast, for a generic W, the monoid of representations is the Kronecker monoid. And this guy is known to be strictly contained in that. It's considerably smaller than this. So this example of generic tensors impressively shows that the monoid representations for orbit and orbit closure, they can differ substantially. Okay.
Do you know exactly the difference in their growths? The asymptotics of the difference of the growths of those two sets?
You ask me, maybe Nicolas Risser. And Nicolas has these equations for separating hyperplanes for this, for the cone of this. No. But I don't think it's...
I don't think it's known. And then you have to quantify it. There's some measure of quantity.
Okay, maybe I could say Matthias has papers where you have, for small cases, you have computed the cones generated by this and this and compared them. It was a paper in Science or... Okay. Let me go on, because I'm running short of time. So, the stabilizer of the unit tensor. Okay, here is the unit tensor again. What is the stabilizer? Well, here it is. What we can do, this is our triple of diagonal matrices, and I require for all indices rho, A rho times B rho times 0 equals 1. This is clearly in the stabilizer. Then I can also simultaneously permute the coordinates. That's all. And then one can prove, and this is certainly true, the stabilizer is generated by these two transformations. It's the semi-direct product. Okay. This is also okay.
And symmetric group S3.
No. SM.
Oh, SM.
SM. All the permutations.
And then what about the S3 acting on the spacer?
It's not on the large group, so you don't consider that.
What?
It's not on the large group. Stabilizer with reference to what action?
It's not in the product of the three GLMs, of course. Okay.
So we know the stabilizer. Okay, let's go on. Now I want to discuss a couple of things that some of them I realized only recently. Now we are back to the notion of stability, but I consider the subgroup G sub S. It's now the product of the SLs. Then I learned just before from Laurent's talk I should call this polystable, so I wrote W stable if this orbit, this SL orbit is closed, so maybe I should say polystable. This can be shown with the help of the Hilbert-Mumford criterium, and if you do this, it's quite an easy exercise to prove that the unit tensors are stable. They are stable. And it's essential that if W is stable, then there is quite a close relationship between the coordinate rings of orbit closure and orbit. So I'm going to talk about that. Okay, so let me introduce a notion. Let me say what is the period of a tensor. I think this so far nobody has defined. So I define a group homomorphism from our group G to C star the following way. I just compose the representation with the determinant. So, D of G, I take the determinant. Okay, the group homomorphism. So, if I calculate it, then I get this. So, maybe for simplicity, let's assume that I'm in the cubic case, so these MIs are all equal. Then I just have the product of the determinants of G1, G2, and G3 and take the M squared power. This is a little calculation. Then, let's assume W is stable on the following thing. Now, the stabilizer is a subgroup of G. I apply this dead homomorphism, then I get a subgroup of C star. Let's assume that it is finite. Okay. Then it must be a group of A's roots of unity. And I call A the period. Okay. It's a period. And here is an example. If I have a unit tensor, it's easy to see that the unit tensor, M, has the period 1 if M is even, and period 2 otherwise. So this is quick. I have to go a bit quickly because I'm... How much more? When should I finish?
I'm not responsible.
You wake up the chair. Okay, it's good when they're sleeping. No problem. I can talk as long as I want.
4:50.
Good. So. Okay. Now this is very important what I'm going to say. So please pay attention. I have a stable tensor of period A. Okay? Then I can define the following map from the orbit to C star. What do I do? GW, I map to the determinant of G to the eighth power. This is well defined because, okay, if G, okay, because of this condition, if G is in the stabilizer and I map it, okay, I take this, then I get 1. So it's a well-defined map. And then it's a well-defined morphism of algebraic varieties. And so one has to be careful here. This, okay, this notion that W is undefined if A is greater than 1. So only this makes sense. Eighth power. So then one can prove a little lemma that if I extend this map to the boundary just by 0, then I get a function that is continuous in the usual topology. So I want to discuss the difference between orbit and orbit closure. So I have this extension, but this extension may not be a regular function. So if this happens, and there are many, it happens most of the time, as you will see. In this case, the algebraic geometers say that the orbit closure is not normal. It's in a certain sense complicated. Okay. Now, right. This is a bit more technical. One can define the following monoid. I look at the set of exponents e such that the e-th power of this function here has a regular extension. So, okay. Maybe this doesn't, but then I take powers and I ask myself, what is this monoid? And we have a theorem that says that the group generated by this monoid is actually the integers. So this is the monoid. It generates the integers, and then by general principles we know, okay, somehow it must look something like that. Okay, maybe when I put the dot, it belongs to the monoid. It could look like that. Okay. There could be like a hole, like this could be missing. So this is a monoid. It generates the integers, but this is not contained. Yeah. So it has to, this is the theorem. Okay. Now the minimum element, the minimal positive element of this monoid, I call the regularity. So in this case, 2 would be the regularity. Okay, and then if I take, if this function here, if I take the EW power, then I get a function that has a regular extension to the orbit closure, and I call this the fundamental invariant. Okay, and then one can prove that, okay, naive, this is the naive picture, okay. This is the orbit, and then he has this closure, which is somehow difficult, okay. Then it's the zero set of this fundamental invariant in the orbit closure is just the boundary. Okay, so this function describes the boundary. The boundary is the zero set of this fundamental invariant. That's why I would like to understand the fundamental invariant. And then one can prove that under the assumptions I said before, that the coordinate ring of the orbit is the localization of the coordinate ring of the orbit closure with respect to the fundamental invariant. So, okay. So this was, okay, took some time to prove that. So a regular function on the orbit is obtained in the following way. You take a regular function, like a polynomial if you want, divide by some power of the fundamental invariant. They all have to look this way. Okay. I only need to assume that the W is stable or polystable, nothing else. Finite period, very general. So any regular function on the orbit, when I multiply it with a sufficiently high power of this fundamental invariant, then I get a regular extension.
Yeah. The assumption that the image of that is a finite group.
This I said, finite period. Yes. Finite period.
Yeah. So the zero set is really the boundary, or it contains the boundary?
Is the boundary. Is the boundary. So we would like to understand this. So, they, okay, they have this proper. Excuse me?
Is W polystable?
Yes, this is the assumption.
Then the orbit is closed.
Oh, No, the orbit, the SL orbit is closed. But the point is now to talk about the G orbit. Okay? Okay, I have this proposition, and Schravan has this analogous result for the determinant orbit, and he will talk about it. So, okay, if I have a tensor, cubic format, and the period is less than square root of m, then the exponent is greater than 1, and hence this is not normal. This one can prove, but I even intended to go through the proof, but let me just go. I don't have time. Don't look at it, okay? Don't look at it, or ask me maybe afterwards. So, okay. Right, so what we see, if I apply to the unit tensor has a period at most 2. So if m is strictly great, is strictly larger than 2 squared, also strictly larger than 4, then the exponent is greater than 1, so the orbit closure is not normal. So if m is greater than or equal 5, it's not normal. However, one can show that if m is less than or equal 4, this exponent is 1. Okay. Problem? Interesting problem to determine the regularity of unit tensors. I think it's very interesting. And if you could do that, it would be helpful for addressing this border rank problem. Okay. Another problem, also very interesting in this context, to write this fundamental invariant as a quotient of two highest weight functions. So such a representation must exist. This follows from, okay, I don't have time to explain, but we know it exists. But we would like to have this explicitly. This would give an explicit description of this function. Mathematical. Okay, mathematical explicitness. So,
what?
Okay, so these are, I think, both problems are relevant if you want to understand the difference between orbit and orbit closure of unit tensors. Okay. Good. Representations. So, now, what can we say about unit tensors just from the point of view of orbits? Now, let me just tell you what we get when we apply this Peter Weil theorem. So this I recalled. I recall also what was the stabilizer of the unit tensor. Okay. And you need to explain this notion, otherwise you won't understand. So V lambda I is an irreducible GL Lamb module of weight lambda I. So I consider its decomposition into weight spaces. Now I assume you know what this is. The weight space decomposition, okay, alphas are the weight, and this is denoted this way. Oops. Now, the group SM operates on ZM by permutation. And step alpha is the stabilizer of this operation. Okay, so for instance, if alpha has distinct entries, then the stabilizer is trivial. Okay. Okay, then we have this theorem, branching formula. By the way, when I don't mention names, it's from a paper, it's from papers with Christian myself. So we prove this branching formula. Okay, we have a lambda bar. And this multiplicity here, this refers to orbit, is the following thing. You sum over all partitions alpha of D into at most n parts. Of what? Okay, you have this. Now these guys come from the weight decomposition. You have to tensor them, take the invariance of the stabilizer, and you sum over all this alpha. That's, you have this formula. It's very explicit. And you, okay, and we want to, what I want, I would like to have that this is zero, because then I know the multiplicity for the orbit closure is zero. Okay, here again, branching formula. The problem is this is rarely the case, okay? It's hard. You have so many summons, and how can you have that this is zero? Especially if alpha, if you have here, if you have a regular partition alpha here, yeah, alpha regular means that the components are pairwise distinct, then the stabilizer is trivial, and then you get here always something different from zero. Okay, so this you don't want to have.
So the situation is even worse than for the determinant, isn't it?
I'm not sure.
No?
It looks bad. But for the determinant, you don't have a single example. So we don't know. Okay, but here we have, it looks bad, but it, we have an example. Okay, let's look at this. Here is a highest weight. So you have this three times the same partition is a square. Now I try to apply the branching formula. You see what can I do here? If I'm allowed to have, a height of 5, I can go from here to here in the dominance order. Meaning I take boxes and move them down. So if I move boxes down here, I can get this. And I get here an alpha, which is less than this in the dominance order. And here, they are pairwise different. What do I want to say? I made a mistake, or?
The rows are not pairwise different.
I made a mistake here. I wanted to have them pairwise different. Maybe I should. How do I have to do it?
If you want to maintain this partial order, you can't take them.
Yeah, I want to. I move them down.
That's not going to work.
You don't have that.
Maybe I move another down.
No, the problem is you only have three numbers to choose from here.
No, that's not going to work.
That's not going to work.
Okay, this is the example I cooked up yesterday.
You can just calculate it with the computer this much.
I can calculate what?
Yeah, you can compute with the computer. You
don't have to. Okay, there is something fishy here. Okay, with this example. But if I allow 6, then I can do it certainly. Okay. I just wanted to comment on this formula. Okay. Then I move this thing. Okay. No, I can't do it.
No,
it's too complicated.
Never get pairwise the
same rows. No, this doesn't work. Sorry. Okay.
Sorry.
So this is wrong. So this is a bad example. So, okay. Then maybe forget about this. But if I require that m equals 4, meaning that these alphas have at most 4 parts, then one can prove that this multiplicity is actually 0. So. Okay. This is one has to work for it. This is wrong. I'm sorry. I wanted to make a simple example. On the other hand, again by some other computation, one shows that the Kronecker coefficient of 4,4,4 equals 1. So here we have an example of a lambda which is in the Kronecker monoid, but not in this guy. Okay. So this is one example, and the consequence is that a generic tensor of format 4,4,4 satisfies border rank greater than 4.
Which means the Kronecker of lambda bar is 1, right? That's 1. Kronecker of lambda bar, that's 1.
Yeah.
Yes, that's 1.
That makes sense.
I made another mistake here.
Another typo. Sorry.
Okay, thanks. Okay. Now this family of occurrence obstructions. Christian has more time, we'll explain in detail. I hope this is fine now. I want to give you a whole family of such things that work. This will be hooks.
Sorry, I didn't get the conclusion. You said, is the conclusion really that the border rank of most tensors is greater than 4, or is there a difference?
Right. This is the, because what does this mean? You will understand. Because the Kronecker is positive, there is a highest weight vector. Okay, Christian is right. Here I have to put lambda bar. It's an error. Okay? The Kronecker of lambda bar equals 1. This means there is a highest weight vector of weight lambda bar. Okay? Now, this highest weight vector, because lambda is not in this monoid here, vanishes on the tensors of border rank less than or equal 4.
Okay.
Right. Now you see, when you have a generic W and you plug it in into this highest weight vector, it will be non-zero. Okay. But of course, this is much better because we know. Okay. I didn't write it, but actually we know this highest weight vector, so we can actually apply it in concrete situations.
guess okay. My question is, the condition that order rank is greater than 4, you could just have computed by dimension count. You know,
right. There are much simpler proofs. This is the most complicated proof of this thing. Okay, this is the most complicated proof for proving this. We know there are much simpler, just dimensional. I know, that's a problem. So, you know, we know what is this for a generic W. But the natural question is, can we prove it using occurrence obstructions? Very hard. I don't know. Okay. This family. Okay. A family of triples of partitions, and they are hooks of the same shape. Okay, I have a parameter kappa. I take a hook of length 2 kappa plus 1, and which has a leg of length kappa plus 1. Here's an example, kappa 2. So I have 5 boxes in the row, and then a leg of length 3. Okay. Now, okay, you can apply this branching formula. It's not easy. Okay, that's why I wrote a non-trivial application of this branching form implies that this multiplicity actually is zero. Okay. If you do it, it relies on a criterion due to Mercedes-Rosas, which tells us when the Kronecker coefficients of free hooks are positive. Okay, this is a very nice criterion, and if it's positive, it's 1. So if you do this, then you get this. And then one can also show that the Kronecker coefficient of this, now this time I did it right, of the lambda bar equals 1. Again, one can say, the same argument as before, a generic tensor of cubic format MMM satisfies now this border rank is strictly larger than 3 kappa. And then if you rewrite this, you see this is because M is 2 kappa plus 1, you get this lower bound, 3 half M minus something. And the point is, I mean, because, yeah, we can make this, this is for a generic, but we can also do this for matrix multiplication. Actually, we have another, more insightful proof showing why this is zero. When we put here the orbit closure, this will Christian tell you. He will tell you why this is the case, yeah? Okay, and this statement is weaker than the statements with the orbit, but actually that's all we want, yeah? Yeah. The other argument relies on explicit construction of highest weight vectors with obstruction designs. This Christian will explain you on Wednesday. But just to finish this overview, the occurrence obstructions that we have here actually give lower bounds for the border rank of matrix multiplication tensors. So because what we have to do, we have these three hook, okay, this triple of partitions, which are all these hooks, and we just have to show that this type occurs in the coordinate ring of the orbit closure of matrix multiplication. I'm sorry. So this means MN, before I called it MN. This is N by a matrix multiplication. This we have to show. And if we can show that, then we can derive the same conclusion as for generic tensors. So this NNN just is, I'm sorry, 2 notations, too bad. So this NNN, just another name for this tensor of matrix multiplication. Okay. So now I think I can wrap up here. So for finding occurrence obstructions for border rank, we need a way to determine whether lambda does not occur in the orbit closure of unit tensor. So we have a branching format, it gives this information for the orbit. Okay. But requiring that lambda bar does not occur for orbits is an unnecessarily strong requirement. Okay. And then we have these insights that I about the comparing the regular function on orbit and orbit closure, and I think if we understand this better, then it will help us to understand the difference between these two things. Okay, so I'm almost done, so let me go to the end. I wanted to tell you a little bit more about jump over it, Kronecker coefficients again. Okay, if you want to learn more about it, then you can look at the following papers. we had a conference paper at stock 2011. But okay, if you want to know the proof, you should look at the archive version. There's a version on the archive. In the appendix, there are all the proofs. Yeah. Yep. And there was another paper at a conference, essentially self-contained. And we are trying to write up everything. We tried to write a paper with this title. It's in preparation. And we wanted to finish before starting here the semester, but it was not possible. We are still writing. We hope it will be finished by the end of the year. I think the best place to read more about all this thing is the PhD thesis of Christian Ickermeyer that is available online. Let me finish.
Any questions? Do you know that equations that you get, like if you take a closure of this equation, they are different from equations that other people get on the border, above the border end?
I did not.
Do you know that equations you get on border end are different from other equations that people get from border end? Can you prove it?
Okay, what equations do we have for border rank? I mean, we have the Strassen equation, but there are the equations that Joseph and Giorgio have. Yeah, I think you have different, there are different lambdas. In your argument, I don't see clearly these highest, I don't know exactly what lambdas are involved there. So do you know that, Joseph?
It's not so clear
what is in there.
It's not an irreducible module.
But it's calculable, right? So it's
possible. But it's for different range, so they can't possibly be the same. Mm-hmm. It's for a different range of order rank. He's talking about 3 halves m minus 1, mm-hmm. and we're talking about like 2 m minus something. So it's completely different range, so it's not the same. It's different. So they cannot be the same.
Joseph and Christian have a sense of what are the main obstacles to take. So there was progress on the constant in front of n squared is log one. What kind of thing would be needed to get a super constant bound?
Log n.
But what kind of method?
Why do you believe there is one?
Yeah. You see.
I don't necessarily believe, but so there is an upper bound, but you know. I don't know. But if there is, you may tell me what kind of progress on this geometric complexity theory has to happen.
I don't see.
Maybe you can see how you can, you know, what you need. You know, I'm talking.
Oh, maybe I can.
Yeah, high level.
Okay. I can say something. I can comment on that.
But just to say, it doesn't have to be asymptotic, but just the optimal law.
Maybe Christian will say it. So in our construction that I actually didn't talk about, so we did some combinatorial construction of highest weight functions, and then we got this 3/2. Yeah? And of course, we wanted to be better. But we have a way of proving that this highest weight function vanishes on the tensors of small border rank. And the way we do it is combinatorial. So you have to think that you have this exponential sum, and we just require that all contributions, all summons are zero. Okay, this is by some coloring argument. And I think we cannot, if we just follow this route, we cannot be better. Otherwise, I mean, there's some conjecture by Alon and Klim, or Galon, or there's some conjecture on coloring of hypergraphs, and if it's true, and probably it's true. I don't know much about these things, but there is some conjecture, and if it's true, we cannot go above the 3/2. Maybe no Spilka. Alon and Kim, yeah. So, but it doesn't mean much. It just says our way of doing it. Yeah. I mean, we are lacking understanding of the vanishing ideal of these higher second varieties, so. I don't see a principal problem, it's just our lack of, maybe if you want, mathematical ignorance. It could be a problem that the occurrence obstructions do not work because we require too much. I don't know. So,
So I think a central issue is all these things are checking some failure of a space to be abelian, a measure of a failure of space of endomorphisms to be abelian. But what one really needs is a measure of the failure of a space of endomorphisms to be simultaneously diagonalizable. And even that basic question, forget about measuring the failure, we don't know, starting with 7x7 matrices, if a 7, because of work of Laurent, he notes that a being abelian is not the same, or being in the closure of abelian is not the same as being in the closure of diagonalizable is not the same as abelian. And so really the thing to understand is, what is the closure of the diagonalizable endomorphisms, and how do you characterize that? I think that's the major bottleneck at the moment.
But if you want to measure the distance from being abelian, then no. Is it going to be limited at n squared or something?
No, because you're measuring these different equations can be thought of as measuring different ways of failure of abelianness. So Strawson is failure of abelianness. But then there's sort of second order failure of abelianness, and how fast this, when you start taking brackets of brackets of elements in the space, how fast the space grows. That's essentially what all the equations I'm aware of are measuring that in some way or another.
The hooks as well?
These I haven't looked at.
Okay. But there is a bounded constant n squared log n.
This is for this bounded coefficient model by Ron Ross. Yeah. It's not. It's very nice result, but it doesn't say anything about this model.
But it would indicate that.
Yes, it indicates.
All of n squared, right?
Why not?
Yeah.
Because of the other lower bound.
There is this result by Ron Ross that says in the model, these bilinear computations where you bound the coefficients in absolute value, say by 2, then you need n squared log n.
So
it's different. It's not algebraic.
I have not seen any evidence that indicates that the order rank of matrix multiplication must be over 2n squared. I mean,
you can see it as an evidence about this. Yeah.
You know.
Okay. Thank you very much. So,